Hey, it's Michael J. And today we're going to talk about an actor who wasn't with us for very long. He was very big in the 30s. Well, I should say he was growing into a bigger and bigger star in the 30s, and then his life was suddenly cut short. His name is Ross Alexander. So in this video today, I'm going to tell you about the tragedy of Ross Alexander. Ross Alexander was born Alexander Ross Smith in Brooklyn, but grew up in Rochester, New York, where he pursued soccer, swimming, and drama, performing in community theater productions. He made his Broadway debut as a teen in Enter Madam in 1920.
I'm leaving for New York right away in Dad's car.
New York!
After high school, he moved to New York City and built an impressive resume in productions between 1926 and 1934, appearing in 11 Broadway shows.
I've got a show, a hit show!
In the middle of his Broadway run, Ross was tapped by Paramount Pictures for a role in The Wiser Sex in 1932, but no further film offers came from it. However, after a few more Broadway productions, Warner Brothers took notice and decided he would be useful in their new line of musicals. In 1935, he was cast in the extravagant all-star film of A Midsummer Night's Dream to play Demetrius. Although the role was considerably cut down from the play, it was still a major boost to his rising star to be playing alongside James Cagney, Mickey Rooney, Olivia de Havilland, Joe E. Brown, and Dick Powell.
Lysander, keep your Hermia. I want none. If once I loved her, all that love is gone. My heart to her but as a guest sojourn. And now to Helena is at home returned, there to remain.
That same year for Warner Brothers, he took on the role of Jeremy Pitt, Errol Flynn's sidekick in Captain Blood. Here he had the best dramatic role of his career to date.
Food or water until you talk.
Who did this?
Bishop.
Bishop.
I didn't tell him. I didn't.
Peter, is our boat still standing in at the bay?
Yes, Jack.
I wondered if I was still out of my mind. I've been seeing boats sailing in and out, in and out. But ours will never sail. Not now. Or if it does, you'll sail without me.
What? And get lost at sea without our navigator? Nonsense, lad, nonsense.
We're not going this time. It's hopeless for all of us.
We'll manage somehow.
Must you be forever sleeping when I need you?
I wasn't sleeping, Peter. I was...
Never mind. Get ready to go about. Set the course for Port Royal.
Port Royal?
Port Royal?
But, Peter, the English fleet is at Port Royal. Colonel Bishop...
Sweet, merciful heaven. Haven't you ears? Set the course for Port Royal! Haul over your helm. West by north.
West by north, sir.
Ross Alexander's career seemed to be full of promise. But just after Captain Blood, a few things started happening for which we don't have all the facts. Warner Brothers started putting him in B-grade film versions of the Dick Powell variety. Also,
Ross Alexander happened to be gay, and there was some reluctance at the studio to put the time and money into grooming him to be a bigger star and covering up his homosexuality. Other actors received the care and attention he was denied, and it's difficult now to understand why, when he was clearly capable of giving excellent performances.
Hasn't budged. Perhaps finally caught up with the storm. If anything, it's worse than it was when he left Guam. 10 minutes out of Manila, and he'd be bucking the worst headwinds he's ever flown through.
We can't let that stop us now. Tell Manila to have half refuel as soon as he lands and take off from Macau.
You can't order men to take off in weather like that.
Let's not waste any time arguing. That ship is in perfect shape. It's had every test in existence.
When that plane reaches Manila, we'll have proved absolutely everything Dad Brun started out to prove. His plane has flown across an ocean. There's too much at stake. Trouble now will wipe out everything we've done.
Everything will be wiped out anyway if Hap doesn't go through.
We've shown that an airline can be flown across the Pacific. Why don't you think of Hap and his men? Why don't you think of Dad Brun? You put him in the hospital, hammered the heart out of him. Well, you're not going to destroy everything he slaved for.
Don't tell me what I did to Dad Brun.
Ross did get married to stage actress Alida Friel, who he had met in 1930 doing summer stock in Cape Cod. Henry Fonda was best man at their wedding in 1934.
Marriage is a great institution.
Who wants to live in an institution?
The marriage did not go well. Alida found out Ross was gay when she caught him with another man.
Impersonating an actor?
Will you be serious? This thing is liable to get into the papers.
We can only speculate as to the stability of Alida Friel, but she took her own life with a rifle in her home in 1935. The gay story got out, and Warners worked overtime to cover up the truth, stating that Ross's affair was actually with another woman. According to Hollywood press agent Jerry Asher, Ross almost went out of his mind with grief and guilt. Within the following year, Ross met Ann Nagel working on two pictures, China Clipper and Here Comes Carter, both in 1936, and they were eventually married.
And then forever and ever, I still have you on my mind.
Very pretty, my pet. You'll pardon my momentary confusion. I thought I'd gotten into a musical soiree instead of a publicity office.
Good morning, Ken.
Hello, gorgeous. Don't worry about me getting sore, Dave. I know what you're up against.
Thanks. Tom, do you remember the famous old ships that used to sail the Pacific in the China trade?
China Clippers?
Yeah. China Clippers. That's what we'll call our ships. Now you get ready to fly the first one to China.
Okay, Dave. Good luck.
Thanks.
Goodbye, Gene. Good luck.
Thanks. Hurt me.
Marriage to Nagel didn't alleviate an escalating depression, and more problems arose as Ross campaigned to play opposite Betty Davis. Davis was irritated and complained to studio executives.
You were so awkward that I almost laughed in your face at first, and then it made me quite sick to think that anyone could be stupid enough to be taken in by a lot of old tricks.
The studio lost faith with Ross, and his career slipped quickly. Within only 5 months of his marriage to Ann Nagel, Ross Alexander shot himself at his home. He was only 29 years old. His last movie, Ready, Willing, and Able, opened after his death in 1937. He was only billed fifth, even though he was the co-star to Ruby Keeler. This is because the film was released after Alexander's suicide, and the studio wanted to downplay his name in publicity.
Sensational.
Let's hop over to Amalgamated Pictures and see what McNeil thinks of our script.
Without pitch?
Sure, then we'll have nothing to lose. Come in.
Just a quiet evening. No band with trumpets. Just tea with crumpets. That's what we'll do. I can't tell you how much I've been looking forward to. Just a quiet evening alone with you.
You mean to tell me you're not Jane Clark?
Well, that is my name, but I'm not the actress. I'm sorry, Barry. But it all started when Van mistook me for the other Jane Clark, and I went through with it because I'd always wanted to go on the stage, and this was my chance.
That's fine. That's great. Your chance to go on the stage, of course, is just $25,000. This is a swell joke on me.
Believe me, darling, I wouldn't have hurt you for the world.
Now you can go home and keep the folks in hysterics with the story of how the little amateur fooled the Broadway wise guy.
Please,
it ought to make a swell story. And when you're telling it, don't forget that English accent.
It's horrible to think that this promising young actor was so tormented in life. You wonder if he would have fared better had he stayed on Broadway. Hollywood was not kind to gay actors, yet many survived it and lived long lives, even as some just couldn't handle the restrictions and pressures of the industry. But in his short adult life, he managed to appear in 11 Broadway shows, and his 17 films, especially a few great classics, allow him to live on.
Oh!